he insisted that I talk about what was happening in the region in a contemporary manner. Having studied philosophy, I have generally not wanted to talk about that because you can't really be a party and a judge. I can't be impartial. But I guess it was in the cards, as they say, because we do have to talk about the contemporary situation with the death of Hugo Chavez. This is a turning point. I'm not saying everything will happen, but it's obviously something that is extremely important because Chavez has represented a current in Latin America that has been part of the complex situation there. I think we have to start out understanding that Chavez's military background has a lot to do with his belief in a directed economy, a planned economy. The armed forces of the country, as they depend from the state, and as their very disciplined hierarchy, are not a democratic institution. So they tend to believe that the state should run everything. And when you take a person of Chavez's background, a humble background, usually the armed forces is, in most of Latin America, the way to achieve social mobility. When he did his coup, he became a very popular figure by talking and saying that the coup had failed. And as he made a coup against the democratic regime, he was put in jail. But then Mr. Caldera decided that the time had come to run again for the presidency, which means you shouldn't really run when you're over a certain age. Because he decided to break with his party, they were discredited, the two traditional parties in Venezuela. He decided to break with his party. One of the things he promised was to pardon Hugo Chavez. Unfortunately, he won and he kept his promise. A very good idea is that politicians not keep their promises. Because by liberating this person, he had somebody who had a very good image, but he could get no support for his political campaign. And he immediately got in contact with FARC. Here I have to go back to the Cuban Missile Crisis. As you know, the solution that Khrushchev and Kennedy came up with, that they would not invade Cuba. And two, that Cuba promised not to keep exporting the revolution. So he left guerrilla groups, hung out, and those groups to survive continued to be Marxist or Maoist, but they started to get their economic support from drugs. And Hugo Chavez went to them. They had a background of being radical, Trotskyite, Maoist, and they were in the drug business, and they financed his campaign. It just happened, I was between my first and my second government when Chavez won that election, and I was a member of the executive committee of President Carter's group of ex-presidents, democratically elected presidents of the Americas. And I was therefore taken as an observer with Carter, and I got to know Chavez and be one director up close. And I was taken back because he could see all the movement of the powerful people in Venezuelan society trying to surround him. what he wanted to hear. And he treated Carter, he was very careful when he talked to Carter, and treated him like Carter was. It's hard to believe that Carter was a commander of the Navy and a commander of the submarine. And therefore he was treated as a very important superior, and Chavez treated him as military all the times he had visits. And there was no doubt that he won the election fairly and squarely. And so Chavez, I mean, then in that moment, Carter gave him his support, saying he was democratically elected. But I became very nervous when we were invited, or I was invited, to join a group of people who were going to do a new constitution. When you get these populist authoritarian figures, you have one election, and then you never have an election again, because if they don't win because they're popular, they win because they rigged the election. And there's no doubt that his win and everything that happened after gave you an idea of what it would happen. Now, this is a very important thing, because what is going to happen in Venezuela and Latin America with the death of Hugo Chavez? Number one, it's extremely important for Cuba. Maduro was really picked by the Cubans to be the successor. And the Cubans will be very, very active in the future government, because we have to remember that the long years that Cuba was a satellite of Russia during the Cold War, they took great advantage of human development. The United States, the CIA, the State Department, everybody respects Cuban intelligence. Not only are they intelligent, they have very good intelligence, and they have a very good armed forces. If you visit Cuba, you will find big textile factories. You will find mines built by the Russians. None of them have ever operated, but they have great ballet. They have almost 100% literacy and a very high level of health. As a matter of fact, for a long time, Cuba had a better rate of childbirth, death of childbirth, than the United States or most developed countries. But this means that as the Cuban regime depends on Venezuelan oil, because Chavez used to sell it for half the price, he would have, you'd have to pay half of what the oil you got. And as a matter of fact, he would deliver more oil to Cuba than Cuba needed. They could resell it. And the other half, they could pay back in 30 years with a little bit over LIBOR, I think it was insignificant. So he was really subsidizing and sustaining that economy. Now, unfortunately, and I always say to people, there's no doubt we're all equal. Because no matter how rich, how good-looking, how famous, how intelligent, you all have to die. Some earlier, some later. And that's the basis of the concept of equality. And I think you have to take into account that the Cuban regime, Fidel left 7 years ago, he is really mentally and physically very, very difficult. But he no longer runs it, he's more a figurehead. He has a brother who knows that the time is coming when he too will have to leave. He's announced at the last election that this will be his last term, and he's also prepared somebody to be the vice president in case something happens. But there's no doubt that Venezuela, I think, they will go for election. They have a constitution that if the president dies, they have to have election in 30 days. And I think the vice president, Maduro, will have an election in 30 days. Because the sympathy of the people for a man who died is so great that you don't, you know, we have a saying in Spanish, no hay novia fea ni muerto malo. There's never an ugly bride and there's never a bad dead man. Because when you die, everybody remembers the good things. And in our country, where the people are very sentimental and a populace of this nature, it's obvious, not because he respects the Constitution, because all of these authoritarian populists, the first thing they do is swear to uphold the Constitution and the laws of the Republic, and the next thing they do is change the Constitution, and the last thing they do is respect it. But in this case, it probably makes sense for them to hold an election. The sympathy will permit a certain type of democratic legitimacy, which is what they can achieve if they hold an election. It's possible that Maduro may feel that it's better to say, well, I was the vice president, to make, well, some reason, but I personally think there will be an election, and there's no doubt that Cuba is going to be the backbone of the Venezuelan government, because they have the organization, they know how to do repression, they know how to control things, and they will try to keep it going because it's the basis that keeps the Cuban economy going. So I think that you won't notice a very big change, but you will notice that Cuba will become much more active in Venezuela, and you will have a more efficient way of shutting up the media. Maybe I don't know what will happen in the election, but I imagine it's going to become even more authoritarian and a tougher regime, because it's the only way they can survive a multi-party democratic regime. Everybody thinks that it may fall apart. It's very difficult to maintain a situation existing when the leader, or the maximum leader, just like Russia, after Stalin, lasts a long time, both the beginning and the end. So this will have an important effect in all of Latin America. Now, I would like to go back to look at Latin America in a bigger sense. If you look at the New World, North America, the Americas, if you look at it, there's two countries that are more than twice what they were when they started. One of them is the United States, and the other is Brazil. And there's two countries that are half what they were when they started. One of them is Mexico, and the other is Bolivia. And, of course, the Mexicans, it's very easy to understand. As they themselves say, they're so close to the United States and so far away from God. And we had a very big problem. Bolivia is a country that was so rich, it was ruined apart. It was the upper Peru, but the silver mine of Potosí that changed the economics of the world caused the first inflation of an important nature, because it sent so much silver to Spain that Spain destroyed almost all of its industry because they had so much currency that they started buying wool from England and other products from Germany. It was so rich that the Spanish government, or the Spanish Empire, the king, took it out of the viceroy of dependent from Lima and made it part of the viceroy of Buenos Aires. Because the Spanish, if you had Bolivia or Potosí in your viceroy, then you had the right to have all the things imported go through either Buenos Aires or Lima. And this was so important that when the independence took place, Bolivar finally was able to win all the battles and defeat the Spanish, he went to Bolivia and went up the mountain of Potosí, which was this incredible mountain with the tax for not one mountain, Quinto Real. They really financed the total amount of the Armada, and that was a pride that they had, saying we could do that with one mine. And that's why, as you know, in Mexico, you have a Nuevo Potosí. Potosí is a mountain which today still has as much silver as it had. The only problem is that you can't work it as an open pit, because then you wouldn't have the mountain in the middle of our coat of arms. But it continues to produce a great deal of tin and a great deal of silver, although it's worked by very primitive methods. But what I'm trying to say is that in the case of Mexico, it's hard to believe that Mexico, when it started, arrived at what today is Panama. Panama belonged to Colombia, and it was the place where the silver from the mines came across to Cartagena, the Indias, and then eventually it went out through Buenos Aires. But when you look at what happened to Bolivia, what happened was it was too rich, too few people, and too much of it. All of our lives we've had booms. First boom was silver and gold. It was gigantic, as I've said. The impact of Potosí, the economy of Europe and the world, is without question. And then it had rubber, the best rubber, so the Brazilians set up a country learning from the Americans. They set up a República del Acre, and three provinces, Rondonia, Acre, and another were that republic finally became part of Brazil after war. But you can imagine what it is to go to the border of Brazil and be able to fight a war with the Brazilians from the Altiplano of La Paz. It was a very long trip. And the story keeps on. We had a war with Chile, which the Chileans, the last thing they need is more seacoast. But unfortunately, we had a piece of Bolivia which had all the nitrates, it had silver and all the copper, and it's estimated that 60 and then eventually 40% of the gross national product of Chile over 40 years comes from what was originally Bolivia. And this case of a country, we had a war with Paraguay about Bolivia stretched almost to the Paraguay River, and it was financed by the Argentines because they needed oil. Unfortunately, they won and they took a big piece of Bolivia, but they never got the oil or the gas. But as I say, the worst thing in life is to be wealthy. But even then, Bolivia in land mass is equivalent to Texas and California put together. It's a little more wrinkled, but outside of that, it has about two-thirds of the people live in the highlands. The Quechua and Aymaras. The Quechuas were the members of the Inca Empire, and they occupied almost all of the valleys. The highest part of Bolivia is occupied by a tribe that was never absorbed in the Inca Empire, became a tribute, but they were very warlike, and those were the Aymaras. And then you have, of course, the Guarani parts in the tropics. But it's very hard for people to realize that two-thirds of Bolivia are tropical, where the rivers in the lowlands run out to the Amazon, and on the other side they run out to the Rio Grande. So we have a situation in Bolivia where it's been boom and bust. Quinine, then tin, tungsten, antimony, and natural gas, soya. It's just too rich and too few people, and